Welcome to Health Reform 2.0, the only place on the internet for people with a curious mind and a desire for a better healthcare system. Here we take you on a journey of our current quagmire, tell you where it came from and why the government can't fix it. Along the way, we'll tell you some history, bust a few big myths, tell you a few stories, and give you an idea how we can work together and get the healthcare system we want. Let's get started. Welcome to Health Reform 2.0, the only podcast on the internet for people with a curious mind and a desire for a better healthcare system. Today's topic is something that's near and dear to both Tim and my heart. It is on breast mammography versus ultrasound versus breast density problems. Tim has been involved in this, particularly in focusing on breast imaging for detection and treatment for most of his career. And as I said, this area is very near and dear to my heart because my mother died of breast cancer. And my father actually is one of the few men that had been diagnosed with breast cancer, although for him it wasn't fatal. It just required a lumpectomy when he was 63, and he survived it and lived all the way up to basically a full life. But today we want to talk about the impact of dense breasts, the problems that have existed in the healthcare system around women with dense breasts, and some of the things we have today that can solve it if we can get the public behind it. And Tim, you really are the expert in this area, so why don't you take it away from here?
Thanks, Tom. I appreciate that. Yeah, this is near and dear to my heart and to both of ours. We worked on a major project together with breast screening ultrasound. I built a number of breast centers when I was in the diagnostic provider side of the diagnostic imaging area, and I dealt with a lot of breast cancer centers, imaging centers and whatnot. So there's some myths. We're going to dispel some of those today. We're going to give you some facts. But more importantly, we're going to talk about something that could save your life. And if you're a man, you need to listen to this as well, because 1 in 1,000 men will get breast cancer every year. Most people don't know that because no one talks about it. Just as you talked about your situation, Tom,
exactly.
Your family.
Exactly.
And so we'll give you some facts and figures, and then we're going to talk about a little bit about mammography. We're going to talk a lot about breast density and how we can help you understand a little bit more what this means and hopefully save a life or two. So first, I call this the 40 slide. There are approximately 40,000 women die every year in the United States from breast cancer. And you hear a lot about this on TV and the different foundations. Breast cancer is the number one cause of death in women ages 40 to 55. 40 years of age is a recommended age for a yearly mammogram. However, the USTSTF about 3 years ago changed the guidelines to 50 years of age. That had a great deal of backlash from the ACR, the AMA, a number of different medical societies. And most physicians today still recommend the age of 40, as does the American Cancer Center. And 40% of all women have dense breasts. And this is very important to understand. It's because this makes routine mammography screening less effective and accurate. But unfortunately, many women with dense breasts are not informed and therefore do not understand the issue and some of the alternatives that they have in different imaging procedures. So let's talk a little bit about mammography. So Tom, you want to explain what a screening mammography is, please?
Sure. Well, screening mammograms are mammograms that I call, you know, bend, fold, and mutilate for women. They go in, their breast is inserted into a mammographic X-ray machine between a couple of plates. It is squished down. Most women tell me it's painful, although I've talked to many people who tell me how it shouldn't hurt very much, but it seems to me that it's a painful procedure. And then it is sent to a radiologist who then looks at that X-ray and determines whether or not he can determine if there's any form of cancer in the breast that is going to raise a red flag to bring it back for further testing and diagnosis. One thing that we ought to say we should talk about in a few minutes is that radiologists love mammograms because they can do them very quickly and they get a pretty good reimbursement rate for doing them. They can sit at a desk in their screening room and run through mammogram after mammogram after mammogram in somewhere between 30 seconds and 2 minutes. And each time they go through that, they get a nice little paycheck.
Yeah, we're going to talk a lot about that because in my mind, I know radiologists are going to be sending this hate mail, but most breast imaging people would agree. So, again, they've been doing this a long time. Some are better than others. But in general, I only send my wife to who I know is a dedicated breast imager.
Right.
So we're going to talk about in a couple of minutes.
And the other thing, too, Tim, is mammograms are still the gold standard. And if I'm not mistaken, they're 85% accurate. Is that correct? Is that the right number?
It's close. It's probably a little less than that.
Yeah.
Because most diagnostic imaging reads are 30% inaccurate. So it's somewhere in the middle there.
Right. Right.
Again, if you have a dedicated breast imager, your chances of having a good read are significant, as you know, because you've met Dr. Tabar, right?
Right.
We spent time with him.
I took a class with Dr. Tabar that most of the time radiologists go to become qualified to be mammographers, and I'm proud to say that I passed the class, even though I can't be licensed as a mammographer because I'm not a doctor. But
Laszlo Tabar is the number one mammographer, breast imager in the world, for sure.
Well, he certainly set the standard in a lot of ways. The class was very interesting, and being able to compare X-ray mammography and the issues associated with it to what you and I were then doing in whole breast screening ultrasound systems was also an eye-opening experience. The one thing that people don't realize is that when you are looking at mammograms, that cancers are white and breast tissue is white, particularly the fibrous tissue. And Laszlo made the comment that it was like looking for a cotton ball in a cumulus cloud. And that is pretty well accurate. If it's at the fringe of the cloud, you might see it. If it's near the center of the cloud, you won't see it at all. It's almost impossible.
Yeah, most radiologists also refer it to as looking for a polar bear in a snowstorm.
Yep.
We're going to show some slides that will make that very clear.
Right.
So screening mammography is done routinely. It's to rule out potential tumors. And there are about north of 38 million mammograms performed in the United States each year.
Exactly.
Now, diagnostic mammogram, completely different. It's used to evaluate a woman who has a new breast lump, usually found in a screening mammography, and is useful in telling what the lump is. This is called a recall. This is referred to as a recall after a screening mammography. If something's seen that the doctor's interested in taking a closer look at, he's concerned about it, you will be recalled. You get a letter, maybe a phone call, and they'll do a diagnostic mammogram. Now, don't freak out if that happens, because only 2% or so of recalls result in a positive diagnosis. But in a diagnostic mammogram, there'll be more views taken. You may use a different technique of tomosynthesis, maybe some different techniques that they'll use in an imaging process to get a better look at what they may have seen in the screening mammography.
And they may even use ultrasound at that point, but it typically wouldn't be an automated whole breast. It would be focused on a specific region.
They would do this is the difference. They do a dedicated diagnostic ultrasound, which requires a radiologist most of the time to come in the room with the probe, scan the breast, upwards of 20, 30 minutes or so, I remember.
At least. It can be longer than that.
It can be longer, yeah. So, and in some of these cases, it's not reimbursed. And we'll talk about that a little bit. And what goes on within the whole process of breast density, which will be coming up here shortly. So one thing I want to talk about in imaging, there's things called, in any diagnostic, there's anything called false positives, false negatives. I'm going to focus in right now on false positives. This is when a screening mammogram shows an abnormal area that looks like a cancer, but turns out to be normal. this over-diagnostic rate is somewhere around 22% in Canada. It's between 22 and 31% in the United States. The source is diagnostic imaging. So, Tom, if you lump that all together, you can see that with false positives become a major issue, number one, you're going to be bringing back people with doing more diagnostics. You're going to probably do more ultrasound. And unfortunately, in many cases, and we'll talk about this, some personal experiences, the woman's going to be brought in for a biopsy.
Exactly. And the other thing, too, is, Tim, we tend a lot in healthcare to worry about the cost. That's you and I, because it's such a big issue, and it's one of the things that's staring us down the barrel of a very large caliber gun right now. But the toll on women that have false positive diagnosis, the human toll of this, to be told that it's you may have cancer, and no matter how a surgeon or a radiologist or a GP will couch the qualify that this might not be the case, the time from the mammogram that is done to the read for the woman's notification to her to get back to get the diagnostic mammogram done or alternate screening is never a couple of minutes. It's days to weeks. And that woman has to sit there every day with that fear of potential cancer diagnosis sitting on her shoulder. It is a horrible, horrible thing for women to have to deal with.
Absolutely. I'm glad you brought that up, which brings up another point. Routinely screening mammograms, you're screened, you leave. It goes into a batch read. A radiologist will read it. Certain states have certain dates. I can't remember exactly, but it has to be read within so many. The notification has to go out within so many days.
Right.
I don't remember those dates, those time frames at the top of my head right now. Some people do them well. Some people don't. Now, going back to false positives and what happens in a breast center. Very well, in a lot of cases, exactly what you described, you'll do a screen, you'll come back whenever, and you're scared to death when you get that call back. Go for the diagnostic. Sometimes they'll be able to tell you right there, okay, I think it was nothing, or sometimes they'll say we have to do a biopsy. That's not an easy thing, because they go into a biopsy table, the breast is put into a different location, and needles are inserted into the breast. And sometimes they hit the mass, and sometimes they don't.
Right.
And it can be very painful. I've had my sister-in-law, it took him 10 times to get it to the location.
Right.
That's your pincushion. And
right.
So
right.
Some do it better than others.
And this isn't like an injection for the flu shot. The mammogram is a biopsy needle, and it's typically, you know, a very large bore needle, and it's going to hurt no matter what they do.
Exactly. And it's up to 6 inches long. So
right.
There's some tools and things that make it easier. There's a lot of new technology. But let me tell you, it is not something that you want to experience.
And there's been alternative treatments that have come up. I worked with a company for a number of years that was creating a electronic diagnostic system to replace biopsy. And the company ended up selling its technology to a group in Russia. And they're actually been using the system in Russia for a while, but they couldn't get any traction in the U.S. And the main selling point for that is it was an immediate result. It was a result that was happening in real time, and it gave the surgeon a yes, no, or too close to call signal. But the other thing is the gauge of the needle was 22 gauge, which is about the size of the needle you get when you get a shot. So it was smaller needle, less painful, but they couldn't get traction in the U.S. with this to get through clinical trials, and ultimately a Russian company bought it, who was actually doing a trial in Russia for the company.
Damn Russians.
Yeah.
I just hope it didn't go by the same program that Theranos is going through, so that's another story.
No, in the end of the day, the Russians believed it worked, and as you probably know, Russia's way they treat disease is in an assembly line, particularly breast cancer, and they can run these women all the way through, you know, the tests and get them in the system to get that breast excised and get them back into the workforce as quickly as possible. And this became one of the steps they were using in the process. And to tell you the truth, I don't know anything that's going on with it now. When we sold the company to the Russians, I was working for them. I didn't own it. But when that thing got sold to the Russians, the guys that kind of invented it took off and went to do other things.
I hope Bob Mueller's not listening to this. So one thing I want to make a very important point about this, because breast imaging is an art. There's science associated. It's an art. In my personal opinion, I would never let my wife to go. I know most every breast imager there is, but I would never let my wife go to what I consider a non-dedicated breast imager. And there's a number of them. We know them.
Right.
Because in some areas, the radiologist that reads will have that on the schedule for them to do that day. Another day, they may be doing MRI. They may be doing CT or whatever. You want a dedicated breast imager that's read hundreds of thousands of mammograms, has done lots of breast screening, has done a lot of ultrasound, understands breast MRI, and really knows how to read these images.
Right.
And don't be fooled by the marketing effort that hospitals sometimes have, rightfully or wrongfully, of we've got a women's breast center. Review it. Understand it. Do they have a dedicated breast imager? What's the experience?
Right.
Because some places, they'll have a pink ribbon, and that's it.
Right.
Right?
One of the things that I learned in that class with Laszlo Tabar, and again, I don't want to act like I'm an expert in imaging. I'm not. It was an interesting class, and I learned a lot about it, but just the tip of the iceberg. I was sitting there with people that had been radiologists, general radiologists were there at this class, and they were trying to learn how to become good at breast diagnosis, cancer diagnosis with mammograms. And I sat next to a very nice lady that had been a radiologist for 26 years in Tennessee. And I said, you've been a radiologist all these years, you've never been trained to do mammography. She goes, I've been doing it my whole life, and I've always had a problem because I don't do enough of it. I'll do a breast here and there, but I do all these other kinds of radiological examinations of the body, whether it's bone or masses or tumors or things in other tissues. And the breast is particularly difficult for the diagnosis because the type of the tissue in the breast not only obscures, but they really have to, if you're looking at a break in a bone, you're looking for a positive indication. You're actually looking for a visual indication of that there's a problem. But most of the time when you're looking at diagnosing breast cancer with mammography, you're actually looking for something that is abnormal. You don't see the cancer. You'll see that instead of having this nice scallop shape around this tissue, you have a bulge where it shouldn't be bulging. And from her perspective, that was the hardest thing for her to keep in her mind when she went to look at these. So she had come to get trained so she could go back, and this is what she was going to do all day, every day. And that's, radiologists are good, and we're not trying to trash them. They have a business to run as well. There's an economic structure that has to go with running any business, and they have to deal with that. But when it comes to these kind of things, particularly breast-related issues, this is very, very specialized area, and while other people can look at it, they may not be as good at it as someone that does thousands of them every day, and that's all they do is look at it.
Exactly. And you mentioned one point that I want to focus in on. It's the anxiety. And anytime you're sitting there and someone, you may think you have a cancer, but you don't know yet, especially with breast cancer. I mean, this is a very difficult topic. I'm going to explain in a couple of minutes some personal things that I've experienced with this. When you go in and you have the screening, you go back for the recall, and then unfortunately, let's say you go to the ultrasound or you go to biopsy. In many, many centers, that's going to be scheduled over days, sometimes longer. In a regular breast cancer Women's Breast Cancer Center, they're going to try to do it right there, right then, so you don't know exactly what happened. The best benchmark I have of that is Dr. Barclay White in Scottsdale, Arizona. You do not leave, and there's other people like her, you do not leave that center until you know what's going on once you've been called back in for a recall, guarantee you.
Right.
So it is something very important to understand. Don't get caught up in, this is just the way we do it. Demand more.
Right.
Learn and figure out what you want to do.
Well, and that's, I think, important. And that's the message we're trying to get across in our health reform series overall, is an educated consumer is the best customer, to steal a phrase from a jewelry reseller I know. In healthcare, the educated consumer is the person that's going to find they're going to have fewer wasted procedures and better outcomes as long as they're paying close attention. And if you're reading material and don't understand it, find somebody to help you interpret it. Find what we are trying to get made as a facilitator, somebody that can help you go through this, understand it, and make the decisions. That role doesn't exist in the healthcare system today, except on a casual basis. But there's ways that you can reach out and find these kind of people that can help you understand what's going on and make the right decision to go forward. And, you know, I think now is a good segue for us to go into the actual discussion of dense breasts, because I think that will pull these things we just talked together right to the front of it.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. One study, I don't know if I mentioned it, but the only study I could find on the cost of these false positives was done by Harvard Medical School.
Right.
And they estimated it to be over $4 billion a year. I'm sure, Tom, it's much higher than that.
Well,
I'm
and again, sure. that $4 billion is based on the false positive. It does not include false negatives, which is also increases the cost. Even though the women don't think they have cancer, by the time it's then found out they have cancer, their options are less and more drastic and more expensive.
Good segue. So now we're going to talk about breast density, dense breasts. And this is a very serious issue. With mammography, only 30 to 55% of breast cancers are detected in women with dense breasts. This is from JAMA. So this is important. If you have dense breasts, the chances are 30 to 55% are not going to find it in screening mammography.
And JAMA, ladies and gentlemen, is Journal of American Medical Association.
So as Tom was explaining, and there's four categories of density that radiologists use to define density. But remember the issue of taking a look at an arm or broken hand. Most people can figure that out. We call that an Ant Mini, because you've got soft tissue, x-rays are stopped by the bone, by hard material, and you get a nice clear image. And it's easy to diagnose for most cases, not all, but in some cases, you know, it's much easier because you don't have all this other blocking material or density in there that's making it harder to see that bone.
That's right.
Breast is different. So there are breasts that are almost totally, entirely fatty. If you're looking at the screen, it's the one on the left, and you can see you can see through it. You can see the black and white. And remember, x-ray determines between black and white, you know, white being the dense material, black being the fatty material that the x-rays pass through easily.
And different materials have different contrast ratios, which is various, look of it as various shades of gray. So you can see very bright tissues, which are occluding, and you can see the tissues that don't occlude very much are dark. And then you can see things in the middle, and you can determine the type of tissue by the contrast ratio of that tissue that you're looking at.
And radiologists are greatly trained on how to do this and how to read these. If you go to the next level, it's a scattered fibroglandular density, slightly more dense, more fibrous material. You move then to a much more dense breast called a heterogeneously dense breast. And then you get to extremely dense, the one on the far right, and you can see that's almost all white.
Right.
And that's what we call, you know, trying to find a polar bear in a snowstorm, or how'd you refer to it?
A cotton ball in a cumulus cloud.
There you go. Because if you're looking for the tumor in that dense breast on the right, and that tumor is also white. So as Tom explains, you're looking for different formations.
And one of the things, too, is a competitor to automated whole breast ultrasound is tomosynthesis. And tomosynthesis is widely being used today, and it is more effective than a standard 2D X-ray mammogram. It is a mammogram that is taken from various angles around the breast. It becomes a three-dimensional study of the breast. Now, it does improve the diagnosis of cancer in dense breast women, but it does not improve the diagnosis to the same level as automated whole breast screening ultrasound. And the reason If you look at that extremely dense breast or even the heterogeneously dense breast tissue and think of a cotton ball in the absolute center of that mass, as that X-ray in the tomosynthesis is moving around at 360 degrees, that cotton ball is still in the center of the mass. It's still not going to detect it, typically. It will detect it if it's in the fringe and if it's outside of that center mass, so it is better. But it is not as good as ultrasound, which actually is a very different way of looking at the tissue, and it comes up with very different contrast ratios.
So if you talk a little bit about this, but here's a story I want to, it's a sad story. And unfortunately, I hear these stories way too much. So a number of years ago, I live in a neighborhood not far from Tom, and quiet little neighborhood, and we have a homeowners association president like everyone else does, right? And I'm never home. I spent most of my career traveling all over the world. And then I started working and doing something different. I started building and running this women's health program for a company in these breast centers. So I wasn't traveling as much. So I happened to be in the front yard one day, and my neighbor, the homeowners association president, walked by, and he says, "What are you doing? I've never seen you home." I said, "Told him my change in my job and what I was doing." And he almost looked shocked. And he said, "Well, you know what happened to Nancy?" I said, "No, what happened?" That's his wife. "Well, you know, she's been going to Stanford every year for a mammogram. Every year for a mammogram. And they all came back. Everything's fine until this year. And she's got stage 4 breast cancer." I looked at him and I said, "She have dense breasts?" And he said, "Yeah, they just told me that."
Yeah. And the problem is, and the sad thing is radiologists have known again for years that woman had dense breasts.
Exactly. And if you read the books, you'll get an argument from a number of folks, Dr. Welsh being one, that the screening's not worth the effort because it's going to show up at some point anyway. Well, that some point anyway didn't do her any good.
Right.
I can give you 12 more examples of the same thing. I can give you hundreds of more examples of the same thing.
Well, hopefully we can get Nancy Capella on the follow-on show to this and talk to her about it, because she is a walking, talking dictionary and history of this problem.
Exactly. So someone says she has dense breasts, take heart to it. It's important. What I'd like to talk about next is what it means and what's happened with a number of the states. And this is driven, as Tom mentioned earlier, and helped driven by Nancy Capella, PhD. Her foundation is Are You Dense? You can find her on the internet, Are You Dense?
When you first told me about that, I thought you were referring to me, Tom, Are You Dense? And I was going to say, yeah, I've been dense my whole damn life.
Yeah, I thought it was a pretty good tagline. She jokes about it all the time. But she was the main driver, and she has her own story. You'll see it on her website, and it's the same thing I just described. Right. Fortunately, she had a good outcome.
She had a good outcome because she fought.
Yeah, and she was educated, and she really understood.
Right.
And she's a big advocate. She speaks all over the world. Nicest lady you ever want to meet. And she helped with what was called the breast density notification laws. So, Tom, I know you were heavily involved in that in California because of Jerry Brown and the work you did there. You want to explain a little bit about these notification laws?
Well, the notification laws come, like a lot of things in healthcare, with a mixed bag of problems. On the one hand, the history has been, as radiologists, as I said now four times, wouldn't notify a woman that she had dense breasts. And it became clear from Nancy Capella's work to most state legislatures that they needed to at least notify the woman that they had dense breasts and that the mammogram they received might not have the level of accuracy that it is supposed to have. And to some extent, many of the states just literally passed laws that said, well, you have dense breasts, and some of them said you have dense breasts and the mammogram may not be accurate. And some went further and said, you have dense breasts, your mammogram may not be accurate, and you should really go get some other form of screening test, often as automated whole breast ultrasound or tomosynthesis or something else to look forward. The problem on the one hand is it will improve the quality of outcome for patients that have these screening systems, particularly if they're notified that there are dents and they take an appropriate step. The problem for the state is the old problem you and I have been talking about now for a number of episodes, which is the cost. And we believe that people should get these tests, but we have to recognize that there's a cost that's associated with it. And the lesson in California was the best lesson you can imagine. Jerry Brown is a very pro-individual humanist kind of person. But for 3 years, Jerry vetoed the dense breast legislation for 3 years. And the reason was Diana Dooley, head of HHS here, made sure he understood that Medi-Cal, which is California's version of Medicaid, was going to have a massive increase in costs that was unbudgeted. And this is a state that was having a budget deficit that Jerry was having to wrangle every year, and that we could not afford to have these new diagnosed early patients coming in, becoming chronic and having this treatment very on. We didn't have the money to do it. 3 years later, Jerry did approve the bill, but it took 3 years for him to approve it because the cost was going to be so high they couldn't deal with it. And it took 3 years for them to figure out how to deal with that cost. And this is a problem not just on the state level, it's a problem on the national level as well.
So, Tom, the research says the cost didn't really rise that much. You know why?
Yeah, because not many people are getting breast exams, to tell you the truth.
This is my own opinion, and based on also some research and talking to the different physicians and people. Yeah. It's because in most of these states, the notification laws, you get a letter or you get a call, probably a letter saying, right, you have dense breasts.
Right.
Hey, honey, I got dense breasts. Oh, that's nice.
That's good, honey. I like those.
It doesn't say one thing about right, what it means.
Right.
And
right,
the latest research shows that less than 30% of most private care physicians or OBGYNs do not know what it means.
Right.
So
right,
people are calling. They're calling. It used to happen to me all the time. I get a call from an OBGYN. Why did you tell my patient she had dense breasts? Well, I'm required to.
Right.
Well, what does it mean? Okay, let me come educate you.
Right.
And right, they don't like to be bothered because they've right, got all these people calling them. And like I said, doctors don't get paid to have long conversations.
Right. And as I told you from a firsthand experience, I have a couple of friends, female friends. One of them is a nurse in Baltimore. She was diagnosed a few years ago with dense breasts. She got that letter. It basically said she had dense breasts. She mm-hmm, called me on the phone because I was working with you in that automated whole breast screening ultrasound company, which is a mouthful to say. Mm-hmm. And I said, you need to go get an ultrasound. And I tried to help her find a place to go get it, because when she went back to her GP, he had no earthly idea what to tell her. She eventually did get an automated whole breast ultrasound. It came back. She was clean and fine. And she was able to go forward. But she's one of the exceptions to that rule, because a lot of times when they get that breast ultrasound, they're walking out the door with, oh, yeah, well, you didn't see anything in the mammogram, but we did find something.
So I got one more thing on that, because one of the other problems of the notification is that really only 4 states require that insurance cover the screening after the dense breast notification.
Right.
So ladies, you can go get a breast screening ultrasound at many locations. We can help you find them. You can find them on the internet. You'll have to pay cash. And they're usually going to cost you between $100 to $200. I've seen as high as $300. That's ridiculous. But you can get it done if you pay cash. Ask right, the imaging center what they charge.
Right.
But I got another question for you. People say, well, that's $100 or $200. How much do you spend to get a manicure? How much right, do you spend to get your hair done?
Right.
How much time do you spend to get a pedicure?
Right.
At the spa. You're not willing to spend $100 to $150, $200 to find out if you have dense breasts, if you've got something that's so important it can save your life.
Wouldn't it be nice? Wouldn't it be nice if we could have some of those automated whole breast ultrasound systems put in spas where they're doing, you know, Botox and hair removal and nails, manicures and pedicures. And while a woman was getting a manicure and pedicure, she could have an automated whole breast ultrasound done. Wouldn't that be a nice thing to do?
Yeah, but it'll never happen because you have to be in a medical designated facility.
Exactly.
We'll talk about that when we get to telehealth.
Exactly.
Regulations again.
Exactly.
Yeah, I put it on every cruise ship I could find. It was me.
Exactly.
So I hope we've given you some information here. Additional resources, I highly recommend if you're interested in this topic, go to the RU Dents website, Nancy Capella's website. There's a ton of information there, some stories and so forth. Of course, the American Cancer Society has a ton of information. The Susan Coleman Foundation, the Avon Foundation, the National Breast Cancer. There's so much information on this. Educate yourself. Most of the data you read that I've found is consistent. A lot of problems I have with the internet sometimes when it comes to medical stuff, sometimes I don't know what to believe. But this stuff is pretty consistent. And I highly recommend that you educate yourself. And I hope this has been of value. It's very important to me. And I hope it was important to you.
And we thank you for listening. We hope you enjoyed the show. And we look forward to bringing you another show like this very soon. Thanks for watching. Bye. You've been listening to Health Reform 2.0 with your hosts, Tom Loker and Tim Henning. We hope you found the topics interesting, that we answered a few questions, that you laughed a bit, and were entertained. Please feel free to invite your friends to join the discussion, and remember, hit that like button and don't forget to subscribe. Send us your questions to info@hr-20.com. We hope to see you again next time.